My name's Jason King. I'm 48 years old and I live in Wellington City in Hertfordshire. I build large-scale scratch build models of the Titanic. My latest model is the Titanic in 1:172 scale. It's the biggest I can actually fit in the room. So it's 12 feet in length. It took me about 4.5 years to build. It's probably the most accurate model of the Titanic. There's not many models of that sort of size, certainly not in people's houses anyway. I can specifically remember the day. It was the 1st of September 1985, and that was the day that the news had broken that the wreck of the Titanic had been found. And at the time, I was just like a 13-year-old doing my paper round. Every newspaper before I delivered it, I was sitting on the person's doorstep reading that particular article before posting their paper. I think it was probably the longest paper round known to humanity. As a kid, you know, I bought the sort of commercial plastic kits, but was never satisfied and always sort of rushed to get them built just to sort of see the end result. So I always thought I want to try and make one myself. Experimented with lighted models. You know, I had like a 6-foot model that I built from scratch at my parents' house when I was a kid with a huge kitchen strip light in it to light it all up. My first proper scratch built model was a 9-foot 1:100 scale model of the Titanic in its 1912 look. And when I'd finished that, I was still itching to make another one. So I thought, well, I can do a nice display where I have the main model above and then underneath it, I'll have the wreck model as it was discovered in 1985. So it still had the crow's nest intact. And then I got approached by RMS Titanic Incorporated, and they wanted some models for their exhibitions. And they made me an offer and they acquired my two models, and both of them were displayed at various artifact exhibitions around the world. And it was really humbling to sort of see something that I'd literally built in my garage being viewed by hundreds of thousands of people. And most humbling was, you know, my model was next to parts of the Titanic that had been raised from the seabed. So that was a really proud moment for me. And that sort of inspired me to build again. And I built my second model, which was again another 1:100 scale, but it was vastly improved. I changed a lot of techniques on the new model, and I decided I'm going to do something that no model builder to date had done so far, and that was to build a wreck version of the Titanic, but build it as it looked on April 15th, 1912. So this was a ship that didn't have any rust. It was exactly as it landed on the seabed, and it was in its full White Star livery. But it showed the sort of devastation that had happened during the breakup and the sinking. The research for that was quite interesting because I did a lot of sort of reverse forensic sort of things. Sort of gave the impression of, you know, the sheer carnage that happened to a brand new vessel. About sort of 15 years ago, I managed to acquire a really good set of CAD drawings that I used as the sort of like my base template for the framework and the decks and the layout of all the equipment and deck houses. The first job was obviously construction of the hull. The basic ship itself is made out of MDF wood, which is great to cut and shape. The hull itself took just over a year on its own to build and plate. You know, I'd spent many hours sort of pricking little rivet patterns into sheet styrene and going a bit cross-eyed doing so. I've used sheet styrene, which is a great material to sort of cut and carve, and you can press rivet patterns into them and you can get really clean cuts, and they paint well and stick on to the model well with sort of super glue and various other sort of adhesives. Decks, you know, they're actually made of very fine Canadian maple because they kind of don't show any grain and you can get the lines of the deck planking in it. A model this large allows you to get into some really serious detail. So there was lots of repetitive parts that were very difficult to construct. The lifeboats and the davits possibly were one of the most strenuous part of the work because, you know, even though the Titanic only had a certain, you know, 20 lifeboats in total, it just seemed like forever to build those 20. So I'm sort of kind of glad in one respect that it didn't have any more lifeboats. I use a whole mixture of materials, everything from tubing and plastic pipes and wire, metal. The tools I use are just basic modelling tools, you know, scalpels. when Titanic was being built, severe injuries and fatalities were quite a regular occurrence in the shipyards. You know, for me, it's a slipped scalpel taking bits of fingers off, and I'll probably use an entire rainforest of toothpicks and cocktail sticks for glue application. And the painting of the funnels, I probably went for about 10 different mixes of paint. So that started getting expensive until I got to the right one. I'm a regional manager for a company that manages and operates cemeteries and crematoria. We care for probably about 45,000 funerals per year. And everyone knows funerals, you only get one go at the funeral, so everything has to be right. So there's an element of me that's always, you know, thinking a few stages ahead and thinking about the detail and just making sure that everything is right. So it's sort of an attention to detail. So I always had that in the back of my mind, is if it was on the real ship and if it's visible at that scale, I'm going to add it no matter how fiddly or difficult or time consuming it is. It wasn't a case of, oh, that'll do, no one will notice. It was always, it's got to be right. The intricate brass mouldings of the deck benches, I wanted to have all the swirls as best as I could, and in the end I managed to make a very fine silicone mould and cast them in resin, but out of 10 I would make, probably only one of them would get through my quality control. 50% was actually building the model, the other 50% at a time was doing all the sort of necessary research, so trawling through books and images that you can find online, to forums, to corresponding with researchers. All I just kept saying to myself is just take your time, there's no rush, put me music on, sit there with a nice beer and, you know, while away the hours. I'm really proud of some of the real minute detail that probably no one would ever really notice. I think I was one of the first model builders to actually include this three-bladed central propeller that I added, and I'm firmly in the camp of the Titanic having a three-bladed central propeller. I have it on a sort of wheeled table which I can move around the room a little bit if I want to sort of get some photos or if people want to see both sides of the model. In respect of actually getting the model out of the house, I did a quite extreme thing where I had a new window put in the front of the house. Dust is obviously a major problem, so I do have sort of quite a regular maintenance schedule for it, comprising of fine brushing and dusting with paintbrushes, albeit not after I've had a few Guinnesses, and cans of compressed air just to keep the dust off it. The advice I'd give to people is do not rush, just take your time, because I've been guilty of it myself in the past, where you just want to see a finished result off a certain part or see the model finished. The model's going to be finished for a long time. It's just, you know, the building, you only get one shot at it. So more than anything, do your research. There is so much information out there these days that you can find pretty much anything that you want if you just do your research. This model took me 4.5 years to build, which is longer than the actual Titanic took like 3 years to build in its entirety. But I've always sort of said, but they did have 15,000 people building the Titanic and there's only one of me. So that's my excuse for taking so long.